we're going to start carpal bones anatomy. So if you see, the carpal bones are also called as carpus. So these are the total 8 carpal bones, which are arranged in 2 rows. You can see this is the proximal row and this is the distal row. So this is how the carpal bones are arranged. If you see in the hand, you can compare it. This is the proximal row and this is the distal row of arrangements of carpal bones. So they are arranged mainly from lateral side to medial side in an order, like on the proximal side, the 4 bones are mainly scaphoid bone, lunate bone, triquetral bone, and next you have the pisiform bone. So to remember this, I will also say a mnemonic later. So but just understand what are the bones first. So from lateral to medial side, first you have scaphoid, lunate, triquetral, pisiform. Next, on the distal row, you'll also have 4 bones again. That is again from lateral to medial side. That is, first one is trapezium, next the trapezoid, next the capitate, next the hamate. So this is the order of bones which you need to remember. Remember, this is from lateral to medial side. Lateral side means from the radial side to the ulnar side. I'm comparing it with the bone so that you can understand. That is, radial side means you have the thumb. So from thumb side to the little finger side. So here in this diagram, you can see from the thumb side to little finger side, lateral to medial side, how the bones are arranged. So to remember this, we have a mnemonic girl that she looks too pretty. Try to catch her. So this is a mnemonic. By its starting letters, you can easily remember the order, that is from lateral to medial side, all the proximal and distal row bones. So total 8 bones. So how to identify whether it's a scaphoid or tubercle, like that. So let us understand. Mainly we'll start from lateral side to medial side. So first one is scaphoid. So seeing the scaphoid, it looks somewhat like a boat shaped, and it is also having a tubercle on the lateral side. So you can see this lateral side, so it's a tubercle. So on lateral side, it has tubercle and boat shape. So that is the feature of scaphoid. Next, coming to lunate. If you see the lunate, it's like half moon or somewhat like crescent shape. So hence the name also lunate. Next, coming to triquetral. If you see the triquetral, it's somewhat like pyramidal and also has isolated oval facet on distal part of palmar surface. So if you see, this is the palmar surface. On the distal part means, this is the proximal part. On the distal means like that. On that side, it has an oval facet mainly. So remember, the triquetral bone have oval facet on the distal part of palmar surface, and it is also pyramidal in shape. Next, coming to pisiform, you can see pisiform is a P-shaped and has one oval facet on proximal part of its dorsal surface. Dorsal surface means like this. This is a palmar surface, but backside, this is the dorsal surface. So remember, triquetral have oval facet on distal part of palmar surface. So it's on palmar surface, but the pisiform have oval facet on proximal part of dorsal surface on backside. So pisiform on backside, triquetral on the palm. But for triquetral, it's having distal part and pisiform is on the proximal part. So to remember that, you can remember PP. PP means pisiform is in proximal but on distal side, and dorsal side. Triquetral is on distal part of palmar surface. So next, coming to trapezium. So trapezium is a distal row side bone. So trapezium, if you see, it's quadrangular. It is having a crest and also groove. It is having a crest and groove anteriorly, and has concavo-convex articular surface distal. Concavo-convex means concave. First, it's cave-like and also convex, projecting outward. So both type of surface is present. It's a mainly articular surface distal. Distally articular surface. Next, coming to trapezoid. So trapezoid resembles the shoe of a baby. Next, coming to capitate. Capitate is the largest carpal bone with rounded head. So largest carpal bone with the rounded head is the capitate. Next comes a hamate. Hamate is a wedge shape. You can see like wedge with a hook near its base. You can see like hook like structure in its base. So these are the different features of different carpal bones. Now we'll see about the proximal row, which is mainly convex proximally and concave distally. Convex proximally means you can see the convex, not cave like structure, but distally, if you see them, they'll be concave. It is coming to the distal row, it's convex proximally and flattened distally. Next, if you see the each bone have six surfaces. That is, first one is the palmar and dorsal. As I said, the palmar and dorsal surface are non-articular except for triquetral and pisiform. So if you see the triquetral and pisiform, they are having the articular surfaces. Other all bones are non-articular in the case of the palmar and dorsal surface. Next, coming to the lateral surface, so this side, for all these bones, this side will be the lateral surface. For example, for scaphoid, this is lateral surface. For lunate, this is lateral surface. So like that, the lateral surface of two lateral bones, scaphoid and trapezium, these lateral surfaces are non-articular. So lateral surface of two lateral bones, that is scaphoid and trapezium, are non-articular. Whereas six surfaces, palmar and dorsal, are non-articular except for triquetral and pisiform. I have actually discussed triquetral and pisiform are articular in the case of palmar and dorsal surface, and trapezium and scaphoid are not articular in the case of lateral surfaces. Next, coming to the medial surface of three medial bones like triquetrum. So triquetrum medial surface, pisiform medial surface, and hamate medial surface, they are also non-articular. So this are the things which we need to remember. For this also, it's better to create a mnemonics. For example, first we talked about the palmar and dorsal surface, where the triquetrum and pisiform are non-articular. So you can remember palmar and dorsal surface, they are both non-articular. Next, coming to lateral surface, as they are lateral, you can remember scaphoid and trapezium on the lateral surface are non-articular. Next, coming to the medial surface, you can remember the triquetral, pisiform, hamate, as these are on the medial side, so their medial surfaces are non-articular. And the dorsal non-articular surface always larger than the palmar non-articular surface except for lunate. So remember, dorsal non-articular surface is longer. Dorsal, if you see, this is a palmar side. So if you shift it like this back side, this is called dorsal side. On the dorsal side, the non-articular surface is always longer when compared with the palmar side. But for lunar, it's opposite. For the lunar, the palmar side is longer when compared with dorsal side. So remember lunate here. In which actually the palmar surface is larger than dorsal. So now we will understand the specific points of this carpal bones. So let us see scaphoid. The scaphoid is having a tubercle. It is facing downward, lateral and forward, right? And the lunate, coming to lunate. Lunate is a small semilunar articular surface for scaphoid. Yeah, lunate has a small semilunar articular surface for scaphoid on lateral side. So here it will have some articular surface, and its quadrangular articular surface for triquetral is on medial side. So you can see lunate is having both sides articulation with scaphoid on lateral side, and on medial side it has articulation with triquetral. Next, we'll go to triquetral. It's an oval facet for pisiform, lie on distal part of palmar surface, and medially and dorsal surface are continuous and non-articular. This is very important. Medial and dorsal on back side, they are non-articular, but only that with pisiform it's articular. Next, coming to pisiform, you can see it's an oval. It has an oval facet for triquetral lines on proximal part of dorsal surface, and lateral surface is grooved by ulnar nerve. So it has lateral surface, it is grooved by ulnar nerve. Next, coming to trapezium. Trapezium palmar surface has vertical groove for tendon of flexor carpi radialis. So trapezium have flexor carpi radialis, and the groove is limited laterally by crest of trapezium. This is crest of trapezium on lateral side. And the distal surface bears convex or concave articular surface for the base of first metacarpal. So this one, distal surface, gives attachment to base of first metacarpal. So this is a distal surface, and this is a proximal surface. Distal surface, proximal surface. Now we'll move on to the trapezoid. So trapezoid, if you see, the distal articular surface is bigger than the proximal. You can see it's like triangular and somewhat bigger for the trapezoid when compared with the proximal one. So the palmar non-articular surface is prolonged laterally. Next, coming to the capitate. Capitate is a dorsomedial angle dorsomedial. Dorsal means lateral back side. Medial. Medial means towards this side. So the dorsomedial angle is distal most projection from body of capitate, bears a small facet for fourth metacarpal. You can see the small facet for fourth metacarpal bone. Next, coming to hamate hook-like projection from the distal part, this one, distal part, projection from body of capitate. Hamate hook projects from the distal part of palma surface and directed laterally. So this is about the different features of all eight carpal bones. Now we will discuss about the attachments, what are attached. So actually for this carpal bones, the attachments are like four bony pillars are at four corners of carpus. And the tubercle of scaphoid, you can see it is giving attachment to flexor retinaculum, very important. And few fibers of abductor pollicis brevis, even abductor pollicis brevis attached to this. Next, coming to the pisiform, if you see the pisiform is giving attachment to flexor calpi ulnaris. You can understand it's on medial side, so flexor calpi ulnaris, flexor retinaculum and superficial slip of flexor retinaculum. Even the abductor digiti minimini extensor retinaculum will attach to the pisiform. Next, coming to the trapezium. The trapezium gives attachment to the crest. Its crest gives origin to the, as I said, it is having lateral crest. So this crest gives origin to the abductor pollicis brevis, flexor pollicis brevis, opponens pollicis, which are the muscles of thinner eminence. So what are the muscles of thinner eminence? You can see here the thinner eminence is where it is forming near the thumb, right? So the thinner eminence muscles are mainly abductor pollicis brevis. Pollicis means which is going to the thumb, right? So abductor pollicis brevis, flexor pollicis brevis, opponens pollicis. So all are pollicis because they are going to the thumb. So those are all forming the thinner eminence and they will attach to the crest, lateral crest of the trapezium. Now coming to the edges of groove. The edges of groove give attachment to two layers of flexor retinaculum. So you can see here the marginal bones of carpus give attachment to flexor retinaculum. So you can see this is the flexor retinaculum and its deep slip. It is mainly attaching from the hook of the hamate to the crest of the trapezium. From the hamate to the trapezium, you can see the ring will come like this, from the hamate to the trapezium. The flexor retinaculum is attached like this and also its deep slip is attached. And here you can see the superficial slip of flexor retinaculum, which is from the pisiform to the tubercle of scaphoid. So from the pisiform to the tubercle of scaphoid, there will be another retinaculum, that is a superficial slip of flexor retinaculum, and this is a deep slip. So like this, the proximal bones and distal bones of carpal bones are mainly getting attached so that they will not slip during any movement of the wrist joint. So these are how the flexor retinaculum are protecting the movement of the muscles, and mainly muscles which are not going to lose their position whenever there are any positions going on. So what they are saying, edges of groove give attachment to two layers of flexor retinaculum. One is the superficial, another one is deep. The lateral surface give attachment to lateral ligament of wrist joint. The lateral surface gives attachment to lateral ligament of wrist joint. And the groove lodges the tendon of flexor carpi radialis. So this groove lodges the tendon of flexor carpi radialis. Which coming to the hamate, if you see the hamate, it is the tip of the hook attachment to the tip of the hook gives attachment to flexor retinaculum. Medial side of the hook attachment to flexor digiti minimi. Medial side of hook is giving attachment to flexor digiti minimi and also opponent's digiti minimi. This coming to the articulations, the scaphoid articulates with radius, lunate, capitate. So you can see here, this is a scaphoid. Scaphoid will articulate with radius because it's on lateral side, right? So radius will articulate, of course. And also it is articulating with lunate, we know that one. And also it will articulate with the capitate. Why capitate? Because you can see here how it is articulating. And also with the trapezium. And also with the trapezoid. So all the nearby bones will get attached to the scaphoid. Next, coming to the lunate. Lunate articulate with radius, of course, because it's also lateral side. And it also attaches with the scaphoid, you can see. And it will also attach with the capitate. And also with the hamate. And it's also with the triquetral. So next, coming to the triquetral. The triquetral is, first articulates with the pisiform. also with the lunate as its beside, and also with the hamate, and also with inferior radio ulnar joint articular disc. Next, coming to pisiform, it only articulates with the triquetral bone, you can see. Next, coming to the trapezium, it articulates with scaphoid, and also it articulates with 1 and 2 metacarpal joints above, and also with the capitate, you can see the capitate. Next, coming to the trapezoid, trapezoid articulates with scaphoid, with trapezium, with second metacarpal joint, and also with the capitate. Next, coming to the capitate, it will articulate with, you know, scaphoid, and also it will articulate with lunate, with the hamate, and also with the second and third, fourth metacarpals above, and also with the trapezoid. Next, coming to the hamate, it will articulate with lunate, it will articulate with the triquetral, it will articulate with capitate, it will also articulate with the fourth and fifth metacarpals above. So this is all about the articulations, about flexion retinaculum, and also what are the features of carpal bones. So finally, we will see about the ossification. So actually, at the first year, the hamate and capitate start appearing. In the fourth year, lunate start appearing. Fifth year, scaphoid, trapezium, trapezoid. Third year, triquetral. 12 years, pisiform. So by this, we have completed the carpal bones anatomy.